Now, in the lecture notes and also on the slides, you'll find examples of how you can actually apply this new knowledge of magnitudes and the Vega system. And perhaps the most obvious thing that we can do is to calculate the apparent magnitude of the sun. You can put a detector and you measure that the flux that reaches the Earth is 1,370 watt per square meter. If you plug it in into the Vega system, this is how you very naturally get to the value of -26.71. And this is typically denoted as is shown here with this symbol, meaning solar. And many times we will relate to solar quantities actually as units. Now, the other thing we can do is, for example, determining the magnitude in the Vega system at a specific wavelength of the unknown objects for which we already calculated the flux. So that was the object that had the rising flux density that we integrated. So say that we get this flux at that specific wavelength, the way that you would transform that into a magnitude in that specific band, because in Vega we use international system, first thing you do is you convert to watts per square meter, and then all you have to do is to use the equation. You plug it in using that zero point, that value of -18.87. And in this case, you would conclude that the magnitude of that source for which we took a spectrum would be 20.52. Actually, the more proper way of writing that magnitude is not simply as an M, but it's with M with something like a V, because that corresponds to the V magnitude, or with the wavelength that we're calibrating it to. And we'll get to see more examples of this as we go along. Now, the reason why I mentioned that the proper way would be to use an M with a subscript of V is because that would be the magnitude of a star observed through that filter. Filters, professional ones, they look like this. So you can see here above, these are actually my real fingers that don't disappear into the background, that I was holding this at the INT to take a photo for the lecture notes. And this is how it looks like with a professional filter in the R band and in the red. So basically these filters allow you to take kind of photographs, more like exposures on the CCDs, as we'll see, that only let essentially photons with a specific energy. Now, normally what you'd see is something that's here on the right, which shows you the normalized transmission of the filters. So specifically for the R band filter, you could see it here. And for the R band filter, you can see it around here. They tell you about the transmission of the filter. So the reason why our eyes see this as green is because only kind of the green photons are going through, while here we see it as red because only the red photons go through. But this is not the same thing as something we'll cover, which is color in astronomy. Color relies on having two filters, not just one. So the fact that something looks green to our eyes doesn't mean that that source is specifically green. And it's also important to point out that as you have below, these filters are incredibly narrow. And if you have a very narrow filter, such as the one that is shown here, it actually looks much more like a mirror. You're actually not seeing through. So all these filters are pointing to the same place. So they're pointing to the top part of the telescope here. But in this specific filter, what you're seeing is something on the back of whoever's holding this filter. The reason why they look like mirrors is because most of the photons actually get reflected. And therefore this makes it look like a mirror. There's not enough photons that go through at those wavelengths for us to see them. Now let's say that we want to apply our knowledge and calculating magnitudes and fluxes for specific bands. And perhaps you want to do this with a colleague of yours that is not doing physics, and maybe that will be fun. Obviously, because of coronavirus, it's good to keep a distance, in this case, 10 meters away from you. What we can do is to try to calculate what would be a magnitude of one of us if they're essentially sitting or standing 10 meters away. What we need to do this is to realize that, you know, if you've seen The Matrix, you probably know this already, but humans are energy sources. We produce something like 100 watts. But most of our energy is radiated well into the infrared at about 9 microns. So if we calculate our magnitude in the optical, it's going to be very, very high, even if we're close, But our magnitude at 9 micron is not necessarily that large, or we're not necessarily that faint. So how do we do this? Well, very simply, if we want to use this equation here in the Vega system, we need to know what is the flux, in this case, of your friend in the international system, because what we have is a human luminosity, which is 100 watts. You need to divide by 4 pi d squared, where d, in this case, is 10 meters. So that ends up being 100. And the flux that we would measure is 1 over 4 pi watt per meter squared. If you plug it in, then you realize that a friend of yours at sort of room temperature, 10 meters away at the 9 micron band, which in astronomy is called the N band, has quite a low magnitude. I mean, people are quite bright actually, especially if you're near them. And in this case, the magnitude would be -16.12. So you could conclude, and if your friend is feeling unhappy, that they are actually indeed quite bright, even though this is only in the N band. Now, for a more astronomical example, let's say that we've measured through some processes the magnitude of a source in the R band, and that magnitude is 17.4. If we want to calculate the flux density in F lambda and CGS units at 6,000 angstroms, what do we need to do? And for this, typically these problems will tell you what you might need to assume in terms of the width of the band and what is a central wavelength, in this case of the R band filter. So the first thing you can do is to transform a magnitude into flux. So you can use our understanding of the Vega system to rearrange the equation. This would give you a flux that's 3.1 times 10 to the minus 12 erg per second per centimeter squared after converting it from international system. And if you want to then calculate the average flux density, what you need to do is you divide essentially by the width of the filter that you're given here. So assuming that actually the spectrum is flat, this would be a very good approximation. If it is varying, this is only going to be an average. And once you do that, then you get a value which will be flux density. It's flux per wavelength in this case. And you will find many other examples that I encourage you to try on. And if you find something that is not clear, please just get in touch.